Welkom bij Topnames. Vorige week waren Stekel en ik in Austin, Texas bij het South by Southwest Festival. Vandaag zijn we weer terug bij Freedom Lab in Amsterdam. De gast is Tay. Tay, je bent van Tyken. You are from Tyken.
Yes.
What do you do?
We at Tyken, we develop authentication and verification plugins for blockchain technology.
And why is that important?
It is important coming from my personal story and the billions of unidentified people around the world. We kind of worked on a simple, scalable solution to include those people in the identity systems.
So what problem did you have yourself that this is a part of the solution for? So.
On my driving license, it's written I'm born in unknown, or it's in Dutch, onbekend. So every time the police stops me for overspeeding or doing something wrong on the way, he finds it fascinating that it's written onbekend.
That's really on your driving license.
I can show you my driving license.
I've never seen that.
You can see it under the geboorteplaats. It's
onbekend.
Certain onbekend.
Now, so you're the first unknown person
exactly.
we have.
Exactly, I have the most famous driving license in the Netherlands. The reason that it's written onbekend, I was born in Kuwait, and in 1990 the Gulf War started. It erupted in 1990.
Saddam Hussein attacked Kuwait.
Saddam Hussein attacks Kuwait, and what happens is the civil registries got destroyed. And by civil registries we mean where the government is issuing, storing,
birth
and sharing
certificates.
Birth certificates, marriage certificates, academic certificates, and types of documents that relate to who you are. To your acquired attributes on your identity. So with this document, with this registry destroyed, the issuer doesn't have records anymore.
Yeah.
I had a copy. And we went...
A physical copy.
I had a physical copy on paper. We went to Lebanon with my father from Kuwait. And there, after 3 months, civil war started in Lebanon. The Christians are fighting with the Muslims, East Beirut, West Beirut. And our house in West Beirut got bombed. There was a rocket that flew from the east to the west, and our house on the eighth floor was
destroyed. In the middle.
I tell you why, because now the only proof that I was born in Kuwait is gone. The issuer is destroyed. He cannot prove that I'm born there. And the copy that I had, that was an authenticated copy, is also destroyed, burned. And in both cases, it's a man-made disaster, war. So this is why I grew up without a birth certificate. Now, I am lucky because when I was born, my father went to the Syrian embassy. So I was born in Kuwait to Syrian parents. He went to the Syrian embassy and he extracted a passport for me. So on the passport, it's written, I am born in Kuwait.
Yeah.
But this is not a valid proof of birth for the Dutch government.
Only
birth certificates.
Yeah, I know that.
So,
From own experience.
Exactly. Yeah. As a foreigner coming to the Netherlands, applying for a driving license, even if you're coming from Italy, France, Belgium, if you're not Dutch, if you're not born in the Netherlands, you need to have your birth certificate. This is where I discovered I am an invisible man, born in onbekend. So this was the personal relation for me. And when I got introduced into the technology in 2012, after 2 years, I stumbled upon a protocol called proof of existence, where you can register the existence of documents on this technology. I started thinking, okay, what if the Kuwaiti government in 1990 issued such a document on blockchain technology? My problem would have been solved. But there's a bigger problem than Tay's problem, which is the refugees. So being Syrian, my work contract in the Netherlands was not renewed in 2014, in beginning 2014. So my lawyer left me with one choice to stay in the Netherlands. Syria, I cannot go back because I never lived there.
Your father was Syrian?
My father was Syrian.
Your mother
my mom is American.
You were born in Kuwait?
Born in Kuwait, lived in Lebanon, lived in Dubai. So Syria was not in my book, in my history. Like, I went there to see my grandmother, my grandfather on a weekend when I was young, but we never had established existence there. So going in 2014 to Syria was not an option. Even if I wanted to go, there's no airport. There's war. The war is at its climax.
Since when are you in the Netherlands?
2010.
10.
Yeah, 2010.
So explain why and how the blockchain could solve this kind
of problem. So 2014, I apply for asylum. And there I get like the shock of my life, seeing thousands and thousands of people from my country just in a similar situation like me. They're without an identity, they're without birth certificates, they're not allowed to be financially included, they're not allowed to have basic services except from what the COA provides. And the COA is the organization that takes care of...
The Organ Asiel Opvang?
Yes, yes. And this is a very special organization in the Netherlands that does not exist in any part of the world. So Syrian refugees are lucky to have such an organization to take care of them because they provided the basic healthcare, the basic financial inclusion, basic education for everyone. But think about the other 10 million refugees who are living outside the Netherlands. They're simply living in hell. So how can we help those people? And how can we help the Dutch government at the same time do its job in verifying those people in a fast pace? Because time is money.
Yeah.
And time is saving lives. So how do we know that this guy is really from Damascus? So he's really Syrian.
Yeah.
And his documents are authentic.
Yeah.
So what you basically say, if you would have included this kind of proof of identity in the blockchain,
yes,
it would be accessible.
Why?
And available,
yes,
forever,
yes,
for everybody.
Forever for everybody. Why the blockchain? Yeah. Because this is a type of technology that has a characteristic of resiliency. Resiliency, yeah, by meaning
decentralized.
No one can take the network down. Immutability, no one can change what has been
anything
written on the on the blockchain.
Yeah.
So if a certain president or a certain group of people want to delete their ethnicity or change their age, or it cannot happen. And this technology is borderless. It doesn't ask you where you are in the geography and decide to give you access to a service, yes or no. And it is open and neutral. It doesn't ask you for your first name, last name, date of birth to include you in this service. So based on these characteristics, immutability, borderless, open, neutral, decentralized, if we are able to register attributes of an identity, if we are able to have a cryptographic key that is related to your person and that you use it to sign details and data about who you are, then we have a identity registration. And the most important thing is we have it in a way that preserves the privacy of the user and provides the resiliency for organizations. Resiliency against fraud and resiliency against permanent loss.
So how do you keep that privacy? Because you as an owner, you decide who gets to know what?
Yes, or? Here we talk about what we call the DIDs, decentralized identifiers. These are set of cryptographic keys that relate to you. So you issue them, and with those identifiers, you relate to your first name, last name, date of birth, and all these schemas and claims. And with these claims, once an organization, let's say like the COA, comes in contact with you, they can verify them. So they ask you, what is your name? My name is Ahmad. The moment you land in Lesbos, they ask, what's your name? What's your age? Where are you coming from? I'm Ahmad, I'm 24, I'm coming from Damascus. This is registered. The incentive for you when you go to the Netherlands is to use those same attributes and those same claims.
Because that's a guarantee for a quick procedure.
Bravo. And, that's the guarantee for your quick procedure, and that's the guarantee for you to get processed.
Because you can actually validate what somebody's saying.
Yes. And, now, if you validated one time, I might trust Ahmad 10%. But in those 2 years that you're sitting in Lesbos, moving between different camps, if every time you said you're Ahmad, and your friends and family and everybody knows you as Ahmad, and they are all testifying and attesting your claim, that means you're Ahmad. And if you're lying about who you are, and after 20 years you want to claim your inheritance in Syria, and suddenly your name is Saddam, then the piece of land is not for you anymore. Yeah. Because for the past 20 years, you were living your life as Ahmad. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you present false documents that your name is not who you claim, and you register it on that technology, then you're proving that you have committed fraud.
Yeah. Your original idea was to use the blockchain for registering diplomas.
Yeah.
True. You know, from universities or whatever, because I read somewhere a lot of refugees also have that problem.
Yes. Actually, my roommate had that problem.
Then you entered into Rockstart, where you came into contact with Oscar Knappes, a friend of ours, you know very well. That really helped you, didn't
it? Yes, definitely. Actually, Oscar, I met him when I was still in the AssetSec.
Yeah.
There is an event called Bitcoin Wednesday.
Yeah.
And Bitcoin Wednesday in 2015 gave me the chance to talk about Bitcoin and blockchain and to give a presentation about this technology. I was together with the University of Nicosia, who offered me the scholarship.
Cyprus.
Yes. Yeah. They offered me a scholarship to do my master's in digital currencies and blockchain technology. So during the asylum camp, I was studying through my laptop on a MOOC program about Bitcoins, digital currencies, and blockchain. In my talk in Amsterdam, Oscar was after me as a speaker. And there we met. To be honest, I didn't take the accelerator so serious. I didn't have the experience on what is an accelerator and how can they help startups. So the second encounter came in Startup Weekend. My roommate was a doctor. He was a physician. He does heart surgeries. And I was surprised that because he had a family and he had a special case, IND speeded up his process. I came in contact with him after a few months, and he said he's working in Albert Einstein, just filling shelves. Yeah. I said, man, you can blindfoldedly do a heart surgery.
The reason was that he didn't have
Have a diploma. He cannot prove his experience. Yeah. And we cannot tell him, go try on YIP a heart surgery to see if...
Try it three times and prove it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm still, by the way, it's another remark, but if I hear stories like yours, and we hear them a lot, I'm still so surprised. Yeah. You know, how can we how can we leave people so talented?
Yeah, there is talent.
You know, sitting in a room somewhere in Terapel or whatever.
Yes. Actually, he was the inspiration for us to go to Startup Weekend and use his case.
And that was the moment that you decided to change your idea to the...
Yeah, well, after we met Oscar, he said, Tay, you have the Ombikent on your driving license. There is billions of people around the world undocumented. The academic certificate story made us win Startup Weekend because it was easy to explain to people and they saw the value behind it. And we actually ordered a certificate from India in Startup Weekend for $50 just to prove that you can buy an academic certificate from Google.
Oh, how easy it is.
How easy it is. But the real value and the story and the power of what we can do with Oscar and with Rockstart and the network that they have is in tackling the problem of invisible people. And with this technology, we can turn invisible children under the age of 5, we can give them the chance to be invincible. Because the next cure for AIDS or the next cure for cancer or the next big innovative thing can come from anywhere around the world. I was in a small geographic location in a camp with 400 people, and so many success stories came out. Multiply this on a global scale.
Yeah.
How many children they are deprived from opportunities simply because they don't have a birth certificate.
Okay, yeah. then cut a long story short. I mean, this idea, I think, is completely logic, but also at the same time quite brilliant because it really solves a problem. Where are you now?
Where are we now? We managed to get a strong partner with Tyken, which is the Dutch Red Cross.
Yeah.
So the Netherlands Red Cross today is a partner with Tyken, and together
they invest money in your.
They are not investing actually money. They are investing their knowledge and their experience in helping Tyken come up with scalable and real solutions to help St. Maarten, to rebuild St. Maarten, to rebuild the identity systems in St. Maarten, so that we can offer better, faster and more effective aid. Not to say that it's not good now, but we can do it better. We can improve it. Same thing for Malawi. We have on April 5 a meeting with, we have actually a pitch in April 5 at the Humanity Hub in Den Haag. Where we will meet with the Ministry of Defense, with the Dutch Red Cross and Startup Delta to talk about how can we move this relief and rebuild St. Maarten mission on a faster pace. We are also active with the Dutch government. So I'm happy as a refugee to be able to talk to authorities and the government, something that I've never achieved. Not that we cannot do it, but we were not allowed to do it as culture in the Middle East, to talk with the government on innovation. So we have weekly meetings with the Minister of Interior, Ministry of Justice. I just came last week from the Maréchaussée and the Tweede Kamer at the same day. In the morning we were with the Maréchaussée, in the evening we were in the Tweede Kamer. So how brilliant is that for me and my team and for Tyken to participate in this ecosystem and to lay down the foundations for the Dutch generation so that in the future they can use these technologies and they will look at us, the people who helped regulators, who helped the Dutch government understand this technology and bring real-life use cases.
To be honest, I've never had a guest on this table or a story on this table that at the same time depressed me more about the state of the world and made me more optimistic because the strength of people as you are. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you guys also for this.
At the same time, we always ask the question, where's the business model?
Yeah.
What a stupid question it is. But is there a business model
definitely
there?
There is a business model in selling business clients. So we talked about the validation, but actually there is money, time, and frustration saved for NGOs like Red Cross, for governments like the Dutch government, in issuing, saving, sharing, storing,
I mean,
digital IDs.
I mean, let's be honest. Yeah. You know, I've as a journalist, I traveled the world, and I was in many refugee camps. And in every refugee camp, there are 20, 30, 200 people working. You know, receiving new refugees.
You can save costs for them. Like I can tell you, on a certain NGO, it costs them $2 per individual on a registration, we can reduce that cost into cents. And this is where our business model comes in.
Yeah.
But also the business models change. As we go into more partnerships, we realize that what is missing today in the market is also education. So we offer master classes, private trainings at our office in Leiden for politicians, judges, regulators, everyone who is interested in knowing about blockchain and what can they do. We design workshops. And
with how many people are you now?
Are a team of six people, and the big success of Tyken goes back not only to me, but to the backup of that team.
And how did you finance the company?
Actually, we are next week or the coming few days, we're going to announce that we got seed capital from one of the largest and one of the brightest investors in the Netherlands.
Being, okay.
You will hear about him in the coming days.
I assume, Johan asked you here, and I assume he said you can only get be our guest if you tell the story here.
So the actually the investor behind one of the major contributors in Rockstart, Mr. Case Colin, the founder of Booking.com. We met him at an event in Startup Fest in Amsterdam. And there we had a nice chit-chat over Tyken, and we thanked him for putting us on the list among 1,200 applications at Rockstart. They chose only 10 startups to accelerate. So we thanked him for that opportunity that he gave us, and it was actually me and my co-founder only at that time, which is here with us, Khalid. Khalid Maliki, I met him in Startup Weekend, and it was a team of two. So we thanked him for that opportunity, and we stayed in touch. And today that we have launching customers, we have a solid business model. We have one also one of the brightest developers in the Netherlands, one of the brightest penetration testers. His name is Bas. He's leading our technical team. Today we had a successful demo in front of the Dutch Red Cross, where we showed them how can we issue decentralized identifiers and how can we authenticate and verify identities. So all these good things, going to the European Union, going to Europe, to the African Union, Vedicamer, Maroochydore, all these.
This is all a fantastic story, but the problem with this kind of thing, somebody has to take the initiative. Somebody has to take the lead. It's not going to be you. It has to be a government, the Red Cross, the UN. One of the big organizations has to say, this is the blockchain for identity. Because there are many blockchains. There's not one blockchain.
The best thing
who is going to bring this to the next level?
The best thing is our tech stack works on every single blockchain out there. So we're building plugins, identity plugins, that can work on Ethereum, Bitcoin, Sovereign, Tradle, Versus.
Yeah, but Marcel, you agree that somebody has to take this to the next level.
150 years of experience in humanitarian aid.
They're the most reliable organization in the world.
And then you have the Minister of Interior. They're very bullish on this technology, and they're working 24/7 on leveraging blockchain in the new Dutch identity that will be issued, I think, in the next few years. But Africa, our eyes are on Africa, on the African market. Our eyes on Kenya, on Malawi, on Ghana, those emerging markets that will not wait for a bank to come and open a branch to include people financially. They will not wait for a government to come give them assistance on building civil registries. They will just use an open source resilient
technology. You very much support open source.
Yes.
I read on your website. That's I guess a choice of principle.
Yes. Privacy is a core principle that we do not negotiate on. There's no negotiations on that.
Well, that's not an open source. It's not the same. There's more about open source than privacy, right?
There is more about open source
because when you do something open source, you give other people the opportunity to.
But you cannot be a hundred. You cannot guarantee 100% privacy and resiliency if your system is closed by itself.
Right, I agree with that.
Describe you need to be open source.
Describe me your dream. Describe what a refugee like yourself. How it will work when he will make himself known to a refugee center somewhere in Africa in 2 years' time.
Our dream and my dream would be to solve the identity problem in refugee camps all around the world.
So how will it work? In 2 years' time,
a refugee will
come from Sudan to a refugee camp in Kenya.
They will be carrying their phones. They will be carrying their phones with them, like what they are doing today. Or maybe they will be carrying chips in their arms. But let's say they're carrying their phones, and with a simple tap on a screen in a refugee camp, their rooms will be available. Their blankets will be available. food on menus will be available for them, and they will live in a short period of time in these, I don't want to say luxurious places, but human friendly places. Places where,
let's say,
two people in a room max.
Let's say, yeah, peaceful and safe.
Peaceful and safe.
Yeah.
And they won't wait 10 and 20 and 30 months and sometimes years. I met refugees who were waiting 7 years for their verblijfsvergunning to come out. It can be processed instantly. Their skills, their traits, their knowledge can be assessed and verified. And they will be welcomed directly in the new economy that they are applying
for. And it's the way to separate the political refugees from the economic refugees.
Of course.
Yeah.
And it is the way to support, to separate also people who claim being refugees and they're coming to here to pull a terrorist attack.
Yeah.
And real people who are fleeing from those people that are in the Netherlands now, that are in the Europe.
Yes.
So it is also a political discussion, but yeah, it is. We agree that not every single guy who came to the Netherlands is a refugee.
Yeah.
That refugees themselves, they say that's true, but it's not our fault. It's the fault of the system.
Yeah. Now we always take half an hour for an interview. Yeah.
And we could take a half a year with the documentary.
But I don't want to end it before I want to say that I think it's really a brilliant idea.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
I hope
and
you will
we'll keep you posted, guys, on our trips and missions and visions and things change.
Thanks so much for being here, because, well, we always say that the thing is we are in a luxury position. We can ask people to come here and we learn something every Tuesday.
There's one thing else. You know, we've done 30 or 35 interviews about the blockchain. And for a lot of people, it's still very difficult to give us examples, you know, that people really understand immediately. I think this is one of the examples.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks.
So good thanks luck. For that, because we can use your example in our future. Thanks
Definitely.
A lot, man.
Thank you.
Yeah. Dank jullie allemaal voor het kijken. We danken zoals altijd Stekel. Je zei toch een... Godverdomme, man. We hebben het zo afgesproken.
Nee, niet vloeken tijdens de
uitzending. Je zou toch een biertje van de sponsor nemen, van Bier & Co. Normaal zit hij met Heineken, nu zit hij weer met Amstel. Sorry about that. We bedanken nog meer. Natuurlijk Freedom Eleven, waaruit wij uitzenden. Stekel PQR, het bedrijf dat de website host van Fast Moving Targets. En natuurlijk vanuit Groningen, Jetstream. Kijk je live?
Waarom kijk je nou naar mij?
Ja, ik hoop altijd dat je me corrigeert als ik fout ben. Dus ik neem aan dat het goed was.
Nee, is helemaal goed.
Ja, okay. Tot zometeen.
Dag. Ja.